My name's Jane Scarth. I'm the curator of public programmes here at Whitechapel Gallery. And it's really my pleasure to be welcoming you here this evening for this event, Rehearsing Futures Part 1, Life-Affirming Community Practice, in collaboration with Healing Justice London. Tonight's event is part of our summer programme series titled Life is More Important Than Art, which through exhibitions and events explores the intersection of art and everyday life with the role of the contemporary art institution at a time of uncertainty and change. The title of the season takes inspiration from African-American writer and novelist James Baldwin, who proposed that life is more important than art, and yet that is why art is important. At a time when the cost of living crisis is causing severe financial hardship and the after effects of the pandemic are still being acutely felt, we consider the role of art and the art institution in everyday life. What importance can we attach to art alongside these more pressing concerns? And so we are delighted that Healing Justice London accepted our invitation to contribute to this programme by hosting an event as part of this series, and that it could connect directly with their own unfolding programme of Rehearsing Freedoms, which you'll hear more about as part of this talk. For tonight's event, they've invited four exceptional speakers to consider how community responses through the cultural and social practice become part of life-affirming infrastructures. Speaking this evening is Micha Frazer-Carroll, Kwame Lowe, Sanah, Ahsan, and André Anderson. I'll first introduce Micha Frazer-Carroll, who is tonight's chair and is a writer and journalist and senior media and communications manager at Healing Justice London. At university, she founded Blueprint, a mental health magazine, and went on to be elected the Welfare and Rights Officer at Cambridge University Students' Union. Since then, she's acted as an editor for platforms including HuffPost, Galdem, The Guardian, and the Runnymede Trust, and as a columnist for The Independent and a writer for many other publications. And I'd like to say and celebrate that Micha has just published a new book with Pluto Press titled Mad World. Mad World is a book on the topic of mental health from a radical political perspective. So don't miss the chance to pick up your copy tonight in the Whitechapel Gallery bookshop. I'd like to thank all of our speakers for being here today and generously sharing their ideas and their experiences. I'd also like to extend a huge thank you to the whole team at Healing Justice London, who have been wonderful to work with, and especially Fazana, Sarah, Eva, Alex, and everyone involved in making this event happen tonight. So I'm now delighted to hand over to Micha, who will introduce the event and the speakers. Thank you.
Thank you for that lovely introduction, and what a warm reception. I've never had like that kind of reception, so thank you so much. So welcome, my name's Micha. I'm HJL, or Healing Justice London, Senior Media and Communications Manager. And as has just been mentioned, yeah, I've just published a book this week, so I'm still kind of riding high from publication day. I'll start with access, so just a note that we have BSL interpreters, Sophie and Julie, who will be doing BSL. If you need access to BSL, these front rows have a few seats spare. I wanted to begin with thank yous rather than end with thank yous, because there are so many people that we have to thank for this event. So firstly, to all of you for coming out today, we really appreciate it. To the Healing Justice London team and also the Kin Structures team, to Whitechapel Gallery, who have been so, so amazing in helping us organise this event and for inviting us to do this event, and also to our amazing panellists here today. So we have some community agreements that we like to kind of talk through to talk about how we're going to be in the space. And there are quite a few, as you can see here, so I thought I'd just pick out three or so to talk through. So the first one I wanted to talk about was community care. So community care is really important to us at Healing Justice, kind of acknowledging how we're in relation to one another, how we support one another and look after one another. And that's something that I just want to be here in the space, thinking about how can we hold each other if we're having feelings, you know, where we feel a bit activated, or maybe certain topics might feel quite close to us, thinking about how we can support each other in the space. Another one is lived experience. So definitely for me, these issues like
I don't think we should pretend that we come to them just as objective kind of observers. Like, I came to this issue today because I have lived experience and I have a personal connection to it. And I know a lot of the panel also have lived experience. So really thinking about our positionality and how we've come to the issues that we're talking about today. And also then confidentiality. So obviously there are people who are joining online today and also people who are listening through Whitechapel Radio. So it's not a kind of entirely bounded space, but I think being really conscious of what information shared in the space and it not kind of traveling beyond if it feels like it's kind of confidential or sensitive information. Then I wanted to give a bit of an intro to Healing Justice London. So Healing Justice London builds community-led health and healing to create capacity for personal and structural transformation. We work on a community, structural, and movement level to repair and build the conditions for health and healing justice that dignify and support all of us to be well. So by that, it means not only working on kind of an individual or community level or a structural level, but actually trying to build our individual capacity and our community capacity and to kind of heal on that smaller scale level so that then we're able to do the kind of bigger structural change as well. We also use a multi-layered, multi-systems approach and cultural strategy to work to disarm cycles of harm. So again, rather than just looking on that small scale, looking at things like intergenerational trauma, intergenerational harm, and thinking actually, how can we change these cycles? We also nurture cultures towards futures that are free from intimate, interpersonal, and structural violence. Then I wanted to give a bit of context about the event today. So this is part of many kind of big public discussions that we've been having in the lead up with, it's Healing Justice, but in collaboration with Kin Structures in the lead up to a festival that we're doing in October and November, which is called Rehearsing Freedoms. So this is kind of like the biggest kind of big project we've done that's kind of public facing as well. So it's really exciting. And we've been doing lots of like planning and working together towards it. And it's gonna be a month long festival of community health and healing. It's gonna be kind of looking at cultural work, at movement building. And this event today is part of a two part, what we call Rehearsing Futures event series, which will basically look at how do we rehearse those futures that we're trying to bring about. And the next event, which I just want to give a little plug for because it's next week and it's going to be really, really amazing, is called Experiments in Imagination. And that will be held at Conway Hall on the 13th of July, so it's Thursday, at 7 p.m. And we're basically going to be looking at how imagination is a really essential tool for bringing about social change and liberatory practice. We've also got two Rehearsing Freedoms open days that are happening next Saturday. And if you want to find out more information about that, there's some information on Kin Structures' Instagram page, which is just at Kin Structures, so very easy to remember. So then a bit about the format of this event. So this will last 2 hours, and we're going to have a short rest break in the middle. But I want to remind everyone to also do what they need to do in the space. Like if you need to take time to hydrate, to go to the toilet, to leave and then come back, use the space however you need to use it. It's not a formal, you know, it's not school. So just a little temperature check. How's everyone feeling about that setup? Everyone feeling good? Okay, cool. So without further ado, I wanted to introduce our speakers today. So I'll start with Kwame, who's on the far right for you guys. Kwame is one half of Kin Structures, along with Arman Nori, where they are exploring new approaches to building and sustaining community and cultural infrastructure. Their first project, which was in 2022, was a 9-month residency at Orchard Gardens Community Centre on Orchard Gardens Estate in Lewisham, where they worked with local residents to imagine new futures for the space and the wider neighbourhood. Kin Structures are now the curating and producing partner for Rehearsing Freedoms, which is the festival I mentioned, leading on the delivery of this month-long festival of art, community-based healing, and movement building in autumn 2023. Working alongside Healing Justice London and other key partners, Kin Structures are holding the vision for the festival, developing an innovative cultural infrastructural strategy, pulling together the steering group and collaborators, and driving the events and outputs. Kwame is an associate lecturer at Central St. Martin's, where he is the unit lead for the Infrastructures and Transactions Unit on the MA Cities course. This course explores alternative, creative approaches to city making, and the unit goes beyond traditional urban design and planning methods to engage with the realities of fluctuating and emerging forms of economic flows and social transactions. He is also a member of Design Council's network of experts through which he contributes more broadly to research, policy, and thought leadership on community and cultural infrastructure. Then we've got the amazing André Anderson. So André is the headmaster at Freedom and Balance, and that's an art college and, the art college for the artist in everyone. Freedom and Balance helps communities create new knowledge about themselves and their world through art and storytelling. André mainly focuses on democratizing creative thinking in order to fully realize its potential in society, building educational frameworks that help exercise the creativity, leadership, and self-awareness in those who would never call themselves artists, but innately are. One of his recent examples, which was called Authors of the Estate, is a curriculum that explores the question, how do you turn council houses into publishing houses? The end result was a 200-page book written, published, and distributed by Chalk Hill Estate in Northwest London. Then we've got Dr. Sanah Ahsan. She is a trickster, poet, liberation psychologist, and educator. Sanah works in the cracks, revering our messy emotional landscapes and the wild edges of falling apart. Their psychological practice is rooted in liberation and community psychology, drawing on embodiment, therapeutics, and poetics as life-affirming practices to support racialized and marginalized people. Sanah's work centers compassion and embracing each other's madness. They have written for The Guardian and presented a Channel 4 documentary on the over-medicalization of people's distress. Sanah is working on a non-fiction book about the politics of distress and society's relationship with unruly emotions. Sanah's debut poetry collection is forthcoming with Bloomsbury in 2024. So after all that information, now we want to do a short grounding practice just to kind of bring us into the space, which is going to be led by Sarah from Healing Justice London.
Hi, everyone. So this is optional. We really want to prioritize kind of consent with yourself. So if this feels good, then please follow that feeling. You can lower your gaze or close your eyes. And we're just going to try and lean into a moment of stillness together. You can place a hand on your core, so just below your belly button, if that feels good. And this is a centering practice from Stacey Haynes, and we're going to center in four dimensions. So we begin by centering in length, and you can do this sitting or standing, but I invite you all to take a moment to lean into the weight of your lower body. So that's the feeling of your legs, your thighs on the chair, your calves, your feet into the ground. And as we center in our length, as we feel into the weight of our lower bodies, we're going to start to feel our upper bodies stretching, moving upwards, lengthening. You might want to reach up, stretch upwards. I invite you to ask yourself how tall you can be. And as we do this, we're going to lean into the principle of our inherent dignity, our presence. We're taking up space. We're here in our safety, our belonging, our dignity. And as we're centering in our length, I want to invite you to take a moment and turn your attention to your side bodies, the sides of your bodies. And as we feel into our sides, we're calling in the principle of interdependence. We're thinking of who we are in community with, who we're in solidarity with. I'm sending a moment of thought and energy to everyone in the room, everyone online who couldn't be here today. Who are you thinking of? Who are you holding within yourselves? We're expanding the limits of ourselves to include our community and those we're in community with. And next, I'm going to invite you to turn your attention to your backs and your back bodies. And in this practice, when we think of our backs, we think of the people who have our backs, the freedom fighters, the movement leaders, those who have come before us, the huge amounts of histories that we are a product of. Everyone who paved the way for us to be here and be present. And as we think of that through our backs, we're going to move our attention into our depth, towards our front, your front body, everything we are moving into, moving towards, who and what are you a commitment to? And now we're going to bring that all together and we're going to center in our length, the weight of your feet, of your legs, being pulled upwards, centering in our length, our dignity, our presence, our integrity. And we're going to call in from our sides, our community, the earth, the sky, the natural world, the spirit. And then we move our attention to our backs, history at our backs, our ancestors, and moving through us into where we're going, the future, what we're moving into, what we are paving the way for, and what we are a commitment to. You might want to take a moment to take a breath, maybe take the deepest breath you've taken all day. And I want to invite everyone to do what they feel called to do, whether that's to sigh, or to stretch, or to shake, to give yourself a little massage, give yourself a hug, offer yourself a smile. And when you feel ready, I want to invite you all to gently open your eyes and join us back in the room, and if you're online, back in the space. Thanks, everyone.
Sorry, your voice is so calming. I feel so relaxed all of a sudden. So thank you so much for that. So now we're going to talk a little bit, look a little bit at, you know, this phrase life-affirming community practice. Often when we use this kind of terminology, we get people on Twitter and stuff being like, what is that? What does it mean? So I thought it would be nice to kind of look at what tangibly does it look like for each of our panelists today. So we're going to kind of go through, and each panelist will talk for around 15 minutes about their practice and how they kind of engage in life-affirming community practice. So I think we're going to kick off with Sanah.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Hello. How are you all doing?
Well.
Good? Yeah. It's such a joy to be here with you all, and I'm really grateful just to be in this space to affirm life with people that I just really respect and, yeah, have love for. And I think that there is something really special about the fact that you're choosing to be in here when it's so sunny and hot outside. So thank you for being here. I think for me, in my work as a psychologist and also as a poet, but also just a being who's had my own experiences of falling apart and had experiences of really being on the edges of wanting to die. I feel like the move to affirm life can't happen without a soft examination of our relationship with death. You know, I think death knocks on the door of every new day, inviting us to live more fully, right? Inviting us to get more in touch with our aliveness. And when I speak to our aliveness, I really want to emphasize our unruly, really difficult emotions that are part of that, right? So I'm talking about like our anguish, our despair, our misery, our grief, the things that get us in touch with our mortality, that make our flesh feel really, really raw. And I think to practice kind of a life-affirming community practice means being able to hold each other in that messiness, right? Being able to hold the unsightly parts of ourselves with each other in relationship. And that work doesn't just exist in therapy spaces. It doesn't just exist in psychiatric services, which often actually harm us. But how can we practice the therapeutic in relationship with each other? Yeah. And so that's been such a central part to my work. And I look to the elephants as our teachers, right, for how they are in relationship with death. So when a member of the herd passes, there is a ritual, a collective embodied grieving ritual, in which elephants literally use their trunks to feel into every single crevice of loss, right, into the bones of the person that they've lost, or the elephant that they've lost, right, the member of their tribe, right, and that is a collective embodied process, and it's a revisitation, a repetition that happens over sometimes years, right, to that site of loss. Now, for us as humans, I think we are really stripped of those structures required to be in relationship with those difficult feelings, with our grief, and actually, you know, we live in cultures that are completely intolerant to any prolonged expressions of grief. And our understandable hurt, our understandable rage, despair at living on those sharp edges of these systems is perceived as some kind of indicator of sickness, some kind of dysfunction. It is criminalized, it's pathologized, especially for Black folks, especially for Muslims, right? Our emotions are basically being perceived as dangerous. So, of course, we internalize that, right? We start to see our own emotions as dangerous, and we become terrified of being in relationship with our emotions, especially in an embodied way, right? Of re-inhabiting our bodies when our bodies have been sites and locations of real harm. And so I think one thing I want to speak to here is that the message that we're told about kind of wounds and wounding is that it's just our own, like our pain is just, it's our own, or, you know, the stories of trauma are sometimes kind of linked to family, right? But actually, if every single one of us in this room had our wounds in a lineup, right, we might not be able to discern our wounding from each other as easily as we might think. And that's not to kind of devalue or delegitimize the significance of our life events. It's to speak to, we carry the hurt of our ancestry, of our land, of our lineages, and our wounding is deeply interconnected, right? And our suffering is deeply shared within a wounded and wounding world. Yeah. Are you still with me? Yeah. And I think someone who's been so influential to my work is Bio Akamalafe. Just for curiosity, does anyone know Bio's work in the room? Come on. I love it. So, yeah, I love Bio. Bio actually describes himself as a recovering psychologist, which is maybe where I'm going to be going in it. Maybe that's where I'm heading. But he invites us to reimagine the wound as a site of play, an opening and a place of discovery. And I think what we're taught about wounds is that if there is this kind of crack or tear or break, it's to stitch it up, right? It's to move away from it, to deny it. If we're confronted with those wounds in each other, so often we move away. It feels too difficult to stay with, to bear. But what might be possible if we were to stay a little bit longer? Yeah. And I think this is really what the invitation is for a life-affirming community practice, is how can we stay with each other in those places? I think especially in movement building spaces, right, in organizing spaces, there's so much unacknowledged hurt. And it gets acted out because we haven't had the space to really feel into our emotions. And we end up replicating, you know, castle logics over each other. We end up exiling and disposing of each other when things feel too difficult, right? We end up upholding the brutality of hierarchy over each other. Because of course we do, because we are breathing embodiments of these systems. So it's how can we be in compassionate relationship with the ways that we engage with this and then choose differently? If we can feel into the messiness a bit more, we have more freedom and choice and agency, right? Rather than reacting constantly, we get to respond. So part of this practice of freedom is, I mean, I think there are lots of practices in how we can be in relationship with this, but what I want to drop into specifically today is arts, the arts and creativity as a means to do this, right? And I want to just speak to, I'm going to speak a bit more to Celia Hartman's work on this, but, you know, art is a place where we might dare to reveal ourselves, yeah, where all of this kind of messy interiority can be held. And Celia Hartman talks about the beauty of art as a container for the enormity of our grief. Right, it can hold all of that messiness. And it also becomes a point and a portal of entry for us to find a way into to make sense of our own experiences. Oh, sorry, my bad. And I think, you know, what I want to also kind of speak to here is that Sadia, she's speaking to kind of the messages we're told about society is that all of this is kind of a bit terrible. Yeah, there's a too muchness here. And how can art be a means of actually disrupting those lies? And I was working in homelessness for a couple of years, and I think this really kind of, this contagious nature of revelation through the arts was really kind of alive in that work. So we were doing, I was doing facilitating poetry groups on a weekly basis, and they basically were like rap and freestyle groups that ended up being like that, right? And what you'd have is this kind of like domino effect of where one person would share a rap or a freestyle, right? And really dare to kind of reveal what they were carrying, the hurts that they were with. And it would become like this contagious sharing where these freestyles would be in conversation with each other, right? And there was this kind of commune that gets to happen through the space of art. And it becomes its own kind of therapeutic exchange. And this, to me, is a place that there's real delight, actually. There's real joy that we can have a withness in the space of art, because I think so much of our ideas around kind of how we see art is a slightly disconnected, like, witnessing. You know, this kind of consumption of the other, eating the other, right? But how, if we look at the etymology of community, this word communitas, it means a withness. So how can we go from this kind of witnessing the other in this disconnected way to really stepping into this interdependence through art as a site of commune, but also art as a site of imagination, which I know you folks are going to be speaking to this, right? This place that we can dream and imagine and map out new worlds, to build new worlds. And I think it was, you know, I think Frazana was talking about this at the last event, kind of pencil work being such an important part of the work of liberation, right? That art becomes a place where we can practice that. We can practice failure. We can practice imperfection too, right? And also, one other thing that I want to speak to here is like moving into the arts that isn't language, so outside of poetry, kind of painting and image, we get to have an embodied connection that goes beyond the limits of language. I think language is so often, I think it's Maggie Nelson who says that we can't fault language for being a net with holes. I don't want to just like ruin that quote, but basically something along those lines, right? It's always going to fail us to some extent. And so there's something about art as a means to really move us in an embodied way. And that becomes a kind of an invitation into our collective embodiment, right? And I want to just shift gears here to speak about poetry, just because I'm a poet and I love poetry. And writing especially has been, for me, such an important tool of kind of self-discovery. And this quote by Guarda Colomba, I just love, because she's talking about writing as a means of kind of refusal of the white gaze. You know, we are sometimes feel so incarcerated by the gaze of the other. And to find our sense of self and who we are outside of that, it requires practice. You know, it requires, and I think writing has been an essential tool for me, and poetry has been an essential tool for me to imagine another way of being outside of this kind of this incarcerating gaze of whiteness. And I want to just name, like, also I just want to like drop my poetry collections coming out next year is one thing, just drop the plug. But also that, you know, for me, some of the times that I found just real joy in the writing and in the poetry is where the poem can be like an utterance of a new world. You know, there are poems, the collection is really grappling with themes of kind of queerness and Islam and whiteness, mothering. And there's a poem where me and my lover are at the table feasting with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Khadija. Right, and in that, you know, there's an imagining of what else might be possible outside of kind of the imposed, dogmatic, patriarchal, monolithic ideas of Islam that have been fed to us, right? And that then, in that utterance, becomes a place of entry for others, where we all might be feasting. We all might be feasting with the Prophet, right? And so I love, just want to just big up, oh, you can't see, I'm blocking her. Oh, no. Fluke's work. She says here, rewording for a rewilding, that the poem becomes a rewilding. And her work has been so, so influential to me. She's a black feminist therapist, and she's written a book called Unruly Therapeutic. And there's a chapter in it where she literally breaks this quote down in fragments and is in conversation with each line. And it's so gorgeous. I really recommend it. And that kind of fragmentation, I think, is also what poetry allows. It's a refusal of the imposition of the rules of prose. You know, like, you need to have this full sentence and this is the way to write, right? We get to embody that kind of trickster, fugitive way of being on the page, and that's what I love about poetry. And I wanted also, I know I'm like leaping a bit here from one thing to another, but I wanted to bring God into the room. I believe in creation. You know, we're talking about creativity. I believe that everything is creation, and that everything is an expression of divine creation, and that creation is messy. Yeah, one of the 99 names of Allah is Al-Khaliq, right, which is the creator. And I think there's something about, you know, we're speaking about our unruly, messy emotional landscapes that sometimes I think we want to move away from. We can't see the sacrality in it. When we're in the thick of it, we want to get to the other place. We want to move away to the kind of wholeness, right? Or the healed destination. And it's actually, how can we see divinity in the mess? And one of my meditations at the moment has been really, how can we imagine God as a verb? How are we embodying and living a kind of godliness in our relationship? In our relationships, how are we being kind of treating each other and seeing God and divinity in each other? And that's kind of an invitation for community practice, right? How can we see the divinity in our relationships and really nurture them? And, you know, I started at death, and I want to end here with birth, right? We are born messy, right? We're born flesh falling apart, you know, our mother's wombs literally falling apart. And so falling apart is our birthright. And I think with that, I want to leave you with an invitation of nurturance for your own messiness, right? To really meet that with how, I guess, like the tenderness, the gentleness that you would of an infant, right? To really to cradle that in an embodied way, not just for yourselves, but for each other. And I think this is central to a praxis of life-affirming community. Can we really cradle each other as we are? Right, in our messy wholeness. And that is the work of nurture. So yeah, this last kind of quote, I don't know if you can see it. I realize that I'm putting all of these, it's survival of the nurtured, not survival of the fittest. Thank you so much for listening.
Playlist.
just a couple of tunes for freedom that I just thought I'd just drop.
Thank you so much, Sanah. We're born messy. That's so beautiful. This is why I love hanging out with poets. They literally will put things like that. So now we're going to move on to André.
Hi, everyone. So my name is André Anderson. I'm a headmaster of an art college called Freedom and Balance, which I founded a few years ago. Actually, before that, I had a whole history of making art and doing the kind of things that artists normally do, which is go from art form to art form, poetry, writing, self-publishing, graphic design, illustration, all that kind of stuff. But actually, before even all of that, I was a child, like some of you, and I was really into play. And play actually is my first form of creativity and actualizing myself. And lately I've been doing a lot of thinking about play because it's quite an interesting phenomenon that we all kind of know about, which is oftentimes when we're playful in our adult years, we want to reconnect to it and say, I'm connecting with my inner child. But we kind of forget what we were actually doing when we were playing as children. When you're playing as a child, oftentimes, you'll be in a playground and you've got 20 minutes, right? And within that 20-minute framework, you probably have like two or three games that you'll start. And out of those two or three games that you've initiated, the teacher didn't tell you to initiate it, most of them has to do with rehearsing a future that you would not experience until decades afterwards. So if you were to say, all right, cool, we're gonna, be a doctor, or we're gonna like, I'm gonna be the house, and I'm the parent, and you're the child, and all that stuff, right? You're not gonna experience this for a very long time. But we are rehearsing this future, and rehearsing different possibilities, and as you're doing it, you start to think about the future, but you're also developing something in the present. You're learning social skills, you're learning how to play fair, all of that stuff. Or you're learning how to play unfair, that's also a play style as well. And then that is, you're given license to do that for the majority of your childhood. And then once you get a bit older, then you're then expected to know what the future holds, and you're expected to know how to respond to the world when it presents you with problems. But I'm a person through and through. I'm of the trickster family. I'm not a full-blown trickster, but I'm the cousin, basically. And I'm the calm cousin. And like, I'm very much about play. I'm very much about creativity. I want to spend my whole time and my years in that. But that becomes more and more and more and more difficult, because the older you get, people start to ask you when you're going to be serious and when you're going to stop that playfulness. But the thing that I've always wanted to do is that I wanted to stick with that place, so I decided to do art, right? And art went from poetry to rapping to graphic design to photography, all that kind of stuff. And I decided that that was going to be my life, and I was going to stay in that box. What ends up happening is if you spend too long in that box, it's quite a lonely life. And you're doing amazing things because you're always creating new possibilities, but you're doing it alone. And then when you bring it out there, someone might give you a hand clap, but then that it ends there. So what I wanted to do is that I wanted to take that same practice of making art, but then make it something a little bit more communal. So I wasn't stopping what I was doing to teach it. I was going to create what I was going to create anyway, but I made it open source for people to join in. So essentially what we was doing at 4 years old, I'm doing at 31 years old. So what I decided to do is that I decided to build an art college. And this is actually a screen grab of of something that I wrote to myself in the 9th of April 2009. And I was just writing a kind of poem of like what I thought this art college was going to be. I'll read some of it. An art college for the soul, an art college that reinvents the story, an art college with no lies, an art college for your eyes. Leave that. Yeah, I don't know. And this is private, so it's not for, is it? It's the first time you'll ever see my private journal. You're getting me to allow me, innit? Anyway, as I was saying, an art college for your playful side, an art college for the unexplored, and even when it goes here, an art college reimagined. And one of the things I wanted to do is that I wanted to kind of like redefine what art college was, but also redefine what a headmaster is, because I'd never seen a headmaster that's like me before. But I wanted to create that and define that for myself. So that's essentially the ethos that kind of started Freedom and Balance, the art college. One of the first projects that we worked on is coming from a personal place. I'm based in an estate in Northwest London called St. Raffles Estate. And there was a period of time, it's kind of in the middle of loads of different estates surrounding it. And at the time it was known as one of the poorer estates in the UK. That was the story. And then with that story then comes a whole bunch of other stories. So if someone from St. Raffles Estate does anything anything that seems horrifying, you're going into the newspapers and often your name is associated with something that went horribly wrong. So the moment I say I'm from St. Raffles Estate, the moment if someone knows where that is, they're like, sorry to hear that, right? So there's these stories that even though you may not have been involved in anything, I'm kind of a bless you, but it doesn't matter because I lived in this estate that's followed you your whole life. So what I wanted to do is that I wanted to take these skill sets that I've been developing privately and then make it something public again. So I kind of approached 2, 3, 4, 5 of my friends in my estate, and then I said, like, do you want to make a passport? I didn't call it a book at first. I just said that, like, we're gonna tell our stories amongst each other, and then I'm gonna figure out how to make this a book, and then it's gonna, like, open up our doors. So it's a passport for you to go wherever you wanted to go. Over a couple of months, these conversations then ended up being a book called Authors of the Estate that was then printed and given to all 1,000 homes in the estate. We'd done that with our own hands. That was in 2015. And then in 2019, I was approached by this brother here, Nabil Al-Kanani. And he was from the estate up the road from me and asked if I was interested in doing the same thing again. And the answer was no, I wasn't interested, but at first. But then when I thought about it, I realized that, like, from the first Authors of the Estate, it actually created a culture within my estate. It was a small one, but it's still a culture, whereby, like, we now have a group of people in my estate that, like, I could point to their door and, like, an author lives there, an author lives there, an author lives there. And I wanted to see how that play language could be developed a little bit more. So we had a question, a bit of an audacious question, but it was a question. The question was, how do you turn a council house into a publishing house? And then we then set off and made that happen. And then this picture right here is the picture of some of the Chalk Hill authors. And then we then produced the book, which everyone had licensed to sell for themselves. But then again, this then started a whole culture again of, like, conversations and friendships and memories. And actually beyond the artwork, because most of the people don't care about the artwork, right? What we printed is something that is now a memory that if I wanted to, I can pass it on to my children to be like, that's what your dad or that's what your granddad was on in 2019. So I was trying to figure out a way in, like, with the resources that we have, the little resources that we have, how can we create a space of play where we live? The next one is something that's a little bit, we've done a little bit more recently. And again, sticking with the idea of play, I really wanted to, like, not make it too metaphorically. I actually wanted to make a playground. And using my personal playgrounds that I grew up in as a child, I was like, actually, what if you never left the playground and it grew alongside you? So it wasn't just something that you'd done when you was 4, 5, 6, but actually there's a playground that's appropriate for someone in their 30s or 40s or 50s. And my interpretation of that was sandcastles. So essentially it was a games night, which had your Kinect 4s and your Jengas, and the next one that happens, you lot are all invited, yeah? But, like, it also had its own card game, and the card game was, like, a mesh of 50-something questions that are, like, kind of, some of them are fun questions, some of them are, like, life deep questions, basically, but everyone was given a card, and then everyone kind of plays that game alongside other games in the space. But the thing that I was trying to figure out is, like, rather than making play like a metaphor of, like, oh, we're connected to our inner child, if he was to make something that, like, is a playground for an adult where they are, at the age they are, can you grow alongside them? Like, how does that playground evolve? And it's very interesting because even these pictures that are taken, we didn't hire anyone to take those photos. We actually had disposable cameras that had a sticker on it that said, take a picture and pass it on. So even that had a little bit of playfulness and people was taking pictures and passing it on. And this kind of energy you would not get if I was taking the picture. Do you know what I mean? But there's something, even look at my guy from Resolve, right, Akil. But there's an energy that comes from just looking at a space and then figure out what's all the different ways in which people can find their agency in a interesting way, in a playful way. Next up, kind of going back to the college, often when we talk about like meeting up and creating a community, it feels like a forever thing, and it's like we're just going to do this forever and ever until. And I can't do that. I don't have the energy for that. I ain't got the stamina. So what I've done is that I created seasons. And a season is basically a six-week period of time. And what I decided to do was to create a season and give them kind of a theme. And this season was called a Try a Ting season. And it's because I was trying a ting. Like, there was like a retail space that we were kind of offered. And I didn't know if it was going to work, how I wanted to make it work. So I said, why? Let's try a ting. And it worked. So basically how it worked is that we invited people into a space, and then we worked on a brief together. But that brief, even though everyone was working in the space, working on that brief, it also was something that went out online. This was the very last one, so there was five of them in total. But the question here is, if you had 12 months to try a thing, what would you do and who would you be? And then you could choose a medium between a list, an illustration, and a collage. But anyway, all of that, the reason why this was important is that it wasn't just about bringing people into one space, but actually thinking about how that could be something that people was doing anyway. So I have friends who were saying that, I actually sat down with my grandma and we were actually doing the brief together. Or someone said, during lunchtimes at my workplace, I'll get two or three of my friends and work on this brief. So that playful environment then became extended. And then lastly, this is kind of like what I'm working on now, which you're all invited to because it's open tomorrow, Creative Link Up. So we have a space in Portobello, we have a studio in Portobello Market. And we have it open on Saturdays for people to just come and play around. It says like you need to sign up, but don't, just pull up tomorrow, it's fine. And basically the whole thing was like, as you could see, when I first started, it was very much trying to find the infrastructure and how is this gonna work, and I need to build a system with all of that. And that's important, it's important to do, but after a while, my actual ambition is to figure out how you can be more and more and more chilled. So actually, what we experience as adults is very similar to what we experience as children, which was, how do you, within a short space of time, invent a reality, rehearse that reality, and you learn something for the immediate time, but also as well, you learn something for your future self. And I think that's a skill that we all need to be developing. That's me in a nutshell. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. It's really nice to be here. My name's Kwame. I'm one half of Kin Structures along with Aman Nuri, and we're exploring new approaches to building and sustaining community and cultural infrastructure, which I can break it down a little bit more in a second, but I want to start with a bit of context. And to start with my experience of this context, so I'm a descendant of colonized people, and I'm living in a former colonial capital, in many ways still a colonial capital, and I'm navigating colonial institutions such as the museum and the art gallery. And my experience of that context is very complex, but I want to stay with a word, fragmentation. And that's the way I, and I think many other people who share my background, experience this context. And I think that word fragmentation manifests over various scales. And I've got 50 minutes, so I'm gonna have to summarize. But yeah, the first scale is the scale of the individual and how actually trauma, which a lot of us experience, not just from our personal lives, but also from systemic issues, like the isms. And then there's the level of community and interpersonal relationships, and actually how fragmented we are as a country. And I wanted to, summarizing, think about like two, I think, really key political moments in this country, the first being Thatcher, and just to summarize like her whole kind of like time in power by this idea that there's no such thing as society, which I think is like a really, really powerful idea. I don't think it's a good idea, but I think it's really powerful. And then also austerity, and that there's been like a systemic disinvestment in community and cultural infrastructure and social infrastructure in this country. And you can think of them as almost like the arteries and the veins of a kind of like communal collective life, which the same like political party has withdrawn, and that's particularly impacted people from deprived and marginalized backgrounds. And then to think about the level of the environment as well. And maybe like fragmentation is a funny word to use, but I think you can think of it as like a separation almost between people, us as a species, and how separated we are from our environments often, whether that be built or natural, and how that's manifested as a climate crisis, which threatens like literally our very existence as a species. And all these scales of fragmentation, I think, interact. So, yeah, in that context, Aman and I have set up kin structures, and for me, it's like the latest kind of iteration, a manifestation of my personal, I'm going to use like the jargon, life-affirming community practice. And I wanted to just like also say a bit about the word life-affirming, because for me, the idea of life-affirming is like the opposite of fragmentation. It's about wholeness and an attempt at wholeness. A lot of us don't know wholeness because we've not been afforded the opportunity to practice it. We have to inhabit different parts of our identities. So I'm thinking of examples of, you can come into this workspace, I'm going to employ you, but I don't want you to speak a certain way, or I don't want you to dress a certain way. And I guess in ourselves also, for a lot of us, constantly trying to like move between parts of ourselves that feel more palatable or seem more safe, and actually how exhausting that is and how much that limits our like aliveness and our fullness. And yeah, the opposite of that fragmentation then is wholeness. And I think there's also something really interesting about being witnessed in your wholeness as well, and how that affirms your existence as a person, as a full person. And a lot of the work that I do and have done for over 10 years, it might not look like it, but I've been doing this for over 10 years. it's about enabling myself to do that, I think, but also enabling others to do that together, and to practice this like word community, which I actually think doesn't mean that much in this context. I think it does. I think it's a really powerful word, but I think it's been hollowed out. And so kin structures is like the latest stage of that. But I'm going to go back to 2018. 2018 was when I launched In Space, which was an online art gallery for young Black British male identifying creatives. And that was a response to my experience as an artist, but also 20 other young Black British male identifying artists' experience of trying to like share ourselves and our work. And the violence of institutions, really cultural institutions, and that we had to fragment ourselves to exist in them. And actually, I wanted to think about the internet as a way to kind of circumnavigate institutions. And yeah, we released 3 online exhibitions. I curated them. And at the end of almost 2 years, I wanted to do an in-person festival. I wanted to do it in community spaces, not in institutions. Fast forward 5 years, and Rehearsing Freedoms is going to happen this autumn. But to go back to 2020, I was really like, I'd really become aware of how important being in physical space was. And being with other people, like, I feel like part of being human is actually, as I think everybody's spoken about, like, we live through our bodies, and actually being in space in our bodies is such a powerful thing, and the internet doesn't allow you to do that. So, yeah, I wanted to do this in-person festival, but then I realized there was this thing called the planning system. And I didn't even know it existed before, but I realized that there's this whole, like, huge bureaucratic system which regulates and governs the use of land and what can happen or not in physical space and in cities. And so I went away and I did a master's in urban design and city planning at the Bartlett for 2 years to understand that system. And in the second year, I did something called public practice, where I met Ahsan, and we were both community engagement leads in regeneration teams in local authorities. And I could have a whole other 50 minutes on that, but I'll just summarize the saying, it wasn't very good. putting it politely. And I met Ahsan firstly, which was amazing. Like, we connected as friends firstly, I think it's very important to say. And this is Ahsan, by the way, on the left. We met, and we just shared so much in common. I think we'd both come from, obviously, Arden InSpace. Ahsan had set up and was a co-founder of something called Eyesore, which was a print magazine kind of documenting culture in the city. And we were both community engagement leads, and we were like, culture, community, regeneration, like, how do we bring these things together? And just like quite organically, we just got to this question. We wanted to think about how could we build a permanent home for grassroots culture in London? And just to like focus on some of the words, like I think for us, grassroots culture was the culture that we were part of, that we'd grown up in as like being two people of color from London. I think for me, growing up, art was like a real like lifeline. And when I say art, I mean that so expansively. Like, I don't mean like Picasso paintings. It really helped me to understand myself. It helped me to understand other experiences like my own. And coming back to the idea of wholeness, that I was part of something bigger than myself. So we wanted to celebrate our culture, our shared, quite fragile and beautiful culture, being London-born people. And then we wanted to think about permanence as well, because so much in London is like so transient. Like, I think there was this thing called meanwhile spaces. It was like the trend when we were in public practice. You literally were given a space for like a week. And that was like a tokenistic sort of like crumb that you were thrown. And so yeah, we wanted to think about how can we build a permanent home for grassroots culture in London. We did a series of interviews and quite extensive research. And some of the people in the room actually we interviewed, so thank you. Like, it was so invaluable. And we ended up thinking about community centres as this like dormant infrastructure. And community centres, I think, are like often underfunded, they're underloved, and they're such like precious spaces that, yeah, deserve more funding and more love, basically. So we wanted to think about how could art, also not just as an object, but as a process, like revitalize and bring new life into those kinds of spaces. So yeah, we got funding from the National Lottery Community Fund to kind of test this idea out and trial it. And we did this first kind of program in the Orchard Gardens Estate in Lewisham, and they had a community center, which was like, it was purpose built and was like barely used. It was shocking. And we kind of came in to program it, and we worked with six like resident artists, all like really, really talented people who work in different mediums. And so I'm just gonna run you really quickly through. I don't have time to really like get into the kind of nuts and bolts, but the first thing we did was to try and help and facilitate young people, specifically like children, documenting their experience of life on the estate, but also in the wider neighborhood. And then we turned the community center into a recording studio, and we produced a community radio. And then we did a public kind of like guerrilla Tai Chi demonstration in Lewisham Town Center. And the kind of, it was fun. It wasn't too serious, it was quite playful, but what we were trying to do was inhabit a very noisy, quite chaotic public space and like find stillness in it collectively. And then we did a community cookbook, so we collected recipes from around the estate. Obviously there's like people from like all over the world. That's the beauty of London again. We had like recipes from every continent. And then we did a sort of community meal in the center. And this is a picture from that. And then the final thing was like, we'd had this really amazing experience of like connecting with the residents of the estate. We tried to facilitate connections between them in the community center. And yeah, we kind of turned it into a space of creation. And we wanted to celebrate that, but also further connect people and invite the public into that space. And so we did this final event, which was, the concept was to turn what was quite an alienating space and a quite like basically sterile space into something that felt like a home, a warm home, and to demonstrate, yeah, the power of that space if it was used in a life-affirming way. And so, yeah, I'm trying to think of something else I want to say about Orchard Gardens. I think I'll park it there with Orchard Gardens and just say that that work allowed us to kind of test some of our ideas around art and around community centres and around community. And it led to a conversation, a friendship with the incredible Dim, who's in the room. I mean, Dim should be on this stage talking about life-affirming community practice. So Dim is part of where he works for London Set Point London East, and they're a local charity that provides educational opportunities around ecology and nature to over 8,000 school children every single year. And Dim, along with Ramya, almost single-handedly deliver that. So it's incredible the work that they do. And this space is really beautiful. It's in Tower Hamlet Cemetery Park, which was a former cemetery that was kind of allowed to become a woodland again, but was also converted into a park. So to speak to Sanah's point about kind of like the cycle of life, it's very present in that space and the work that we do. And what Dim has blessed us with is the kind of gift of time. And where I've reached with my practice of community practice and of kind of cultural work is the two like most valuable commodities that I think we have as people are time and space to be. And that's it. That's what I got to. I just want to come back and just say a couple other things quickly before I end. For me, just coming back to my background, is I see myself of a really long lineage. I don't know why I'm getting emotional. But yeah, a lineage of people who across centuries have, after like various displacements, after colonialism, after having to navigate colonialism, have found ways to create space and to preserve their culture. And for me, like the work Aman and I are doing, alongside like everyone on the stage, Healing Justice, like there's a whole like army of us, if you want to call it that, but we're just continuing up that lineage. And for me, that's like, I don't see this is a new thing that I'm doing. It's just like I'm continuing a lineage. And in that way, it's a kind of rehearsal almost. Like thinking about the title of this talk, Rehearsing Futures. And yeah, it's so powerful when you think of it like that. And to think of it also as like greater and spanning more time than a colonial institution. And I just want to end by just being like, I feel like institutions often, like the gallery and the museum, think of art as separate from life and culture as separate from the living. Like you go to a museum and you'll have masks on the wall and they'll talk about people like their objects. And for me in this work, art is so much part of life and comes from full lives which aren't always valued. Literally like, yeah, just in so many ways they're not invested in. People are killed for looking a certain way. And you can't say you value lives you can't really say you value those lives, basically. And art comes from those lives. And in that way, life is more important than art. So I just think that's a very true saying, and it's something that, I wanna echo. So yeah.
feel like that was a suitably long round of applause for what you just said. Thank you so much, Kwame. And to all of you, I feel like it is emotional, and I can see the extent to which, and I value the extent to which you have talked about how you're in your work, like you can't disentangle it from your lives. So I really appreciate that. Now we're gonna take a 10-minute break. Feel free to, if you want to meet or chat to the person next to you, you can do that. But also, Whitechapel's gallery is still, cafe is still open. So if you also want to pop out and go to the cafe, but we'll see you back here at 20 past. Thank you all so much. So we're going to come back to the conversation now. I like this though. I like that the energy is that people want to keep talking to each other. That's good. But yeah, thank you so much. So we're going to come back now and have a little bit of a chat about the work that our panelists have talked about. And one thing that I kind of wanted to hear from you guys is like, there's so many bridges and links and overlaps between the work that you're doing. Do you have any questions for each other about each other's work?
So, what is something that, what are some of the things that you're currently hopeful for? Or like, what's the things that you're like looking forward to?
Or curious about?
Yeah, oh, that's a big question. I mean, like I'm excited to like lean into this place of really kind of practicing creativity in its therapeutic in different spaces. So I'm just about to like start a more like long-term position with an organization called Art Against Knives. Do you know their work? Where they're using creativity as like therapeutic interventions for young people who are like on the edges of like youth violence. And so yeah, there's that practice feels like I'm excited about the possibilities of connection. And I think, you know, what really stayed with me was part of what you were sharing, that piece on kind of fragmentation and kind of that being the opposite of wholeness was it really sort of landed with me. And I was thinking, I guess I had questions around that, because I think that it's more that they are maybe in conversation, because to be in our, and I want to ask you about that kind of, like, for you, what is that kind of conversation between fragmentation and wholeness in your work? I know it's a big question.
In my work specifically?
Actually, just your life.
Just generally?
Yeah.
It's a big question. I think I kind of said it a little bit already, but for me, there's like, a lot of us have complex identities, and sometimes I think even like the word identities is a bit reductive. Like so much of who I am is what I've experienced, rather than like this, like feature, this like characteristic of mine. It's like fluid, and so yeah, this is a cliche. I mean, it's just like very cliche and a bit cheesy, but everyone's like a painting, you know. Like everyone's got so much complexity and so many shades to them, and there's so much that's gone into them. And if you just look at them for a second, there's maybe something about wholeness. But then if you look more closely at a part of them, there's like so much complexity that maybe you can't register. And so for me, like, yeah, everybody is a whole, but then within them, there's like so many like little pieces. And I think what I was getting at earlier is that often you just kind of look at one part of somebody or one part of the painting, and you miss so much. And so, yeah, they're in dialogue. There's no fragment about a whole, but often the whole is missed, I think, yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, I wanted to maybe just come back to what André asked as well about what am I looking forward to. I'm looking forward to Rehearsing Freedoms. I think just for me, and I think for a lot of the team from Healing Justice and Kin Structures, it's like, I don't want to get this wrong, it might be wrong, but I think, at least in my like adult life, we're trying to make this like a really large scale, like POC-led festival, and we're going to really try and occupy space. And obviously we're working with some institutions like the Whitechapel Gallery, but when it comes to the festival, we really want to like root ourselves in our communities. And I think there's just so many like amazing people, like obviously both of you, Micha is part of Healing Justice, but so many like incredible people who I've been like privileged to connect with. And I just think Rehearsing Freedoms is just going to be like a chance for that to be really shared. And I think there's like going to be a real power to that. And thinking about like the idea of wholeness as well, I feel like London obviously is so fragmented, like by like boroughs, by like postcodes, identity even. And I feel like there's this like kind of umbrella that Rehearsing Freedoms, for me, hopefully will enable. And I'm just excited to see what comes out of that, really. So yeah.
I feel like I've been thinking about it as this kind of like epic, like coming together of all of these different people in different spaces. I think it's gonna be really special. Do you guys have any other questions you wanna ask each other?
What are your practices of joy at the moment? Both of you, isn't it?
I've got a few things, so I'll list a lot of them. Like, they're small things, but they're important things for me. So prayer is a very important thing. One of the things I was thinking about is, like, gospel music and its impact on, like, Western music. So, like, you wouldn't get soul, R&B, hip-hop, dance. You're not getting any of that. Unless, like, do you know what I mean? Like, let's keep it 1,000, yeah? If it wasn't for what many people, if not slaves, definitely like poor working class people, developed in these buildings every Sunday. And the motivation of these songs wasn't to make music. Like they were using music to get beyond like what they can currently see. So when I'm talking about prayer, I'm talking about like that space in your life that like makes you go beyond like, this is all cool and it like art and projects and all that stuff is cool, but actually there needs to be something that's like that helps you to go beyond that. I love going on walks. I love water. I don't like drinking water anyway. I like the water. Never mind. Whatever. I like video games. I'm heavy on video games. If I'm honest with you, I really indulge in the things that like little André wants to do. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's what he's on. He likes the games. He likes very simple things, innit? So if he wants ice cream, you're getting ice cream, André. I'm a sort you out with the ice cream. And that helps just, that just keeps me integrated. And it helps, like, me know that, like, I have a younger version of myself that's alive and well. And then the older André, he's got some other bits and pieces, but, like, it actually isn't as... We like the ice cream, basically. I prefer to keep him that. So there's actually loads of small things that I do to help, like, keep me grounded.
Yeah, for me, yeah, I resonate with that a lot, what André said, start the inner child. Like, it's people say it a lot, but for me, I've just reached a point in my life where the most joyful moments are the moments where I feel most in sync with my inner child. And yeah, like, Sewing Centre, honestly, like, the time, like, me and Amon spend a lot of time at the Sewing Centre. Dim spends it even more than us. And we have like a few other people that we spend time with there at the moment. We want to open it up. But yeah, there's like a freedom to it. And that's, I guess it's what I was saying actually in the little presentation I gave. But yeah, it's like, it feels so like natural, but also like something that I haven't been able to experience until very recently. And that just brings me a lot of joy. And also like the nature in the park, the seasons. I've become very like conscious and like aware of the rhythms of life. And like just the sun, the moon, the changes in the colours of the leaves. And I wouldn't say they necessarily bring me joy, but they bring me a lot of peace. And they really ground me. And I think from that I can feel a lot of joy. So yeah.
Sanah, what are your practices of joy?
Yeah, I'll name them, but I just realised I had a question that I wanted to ask you as well. But I think similarly, I know you both named nature and land, but for me, that's been, it's just so grounding. And you just so poetically just described like that invitation to presence. And I've been finding a lot of joy in quiet. You know, just being able to actually be in my own company without kind of moving away from it. And kind of just, yeah, delighting in kind of an intimacy with myself and like that piece on kind of like caring and being with your inner child in a way that is nurturing, but also just like playful. Like I've kind of just gone back to doing sports that I loved as a child. So like football and squash and just really getting in my body. And I know you named prayer. I think there's something about being able to kind of re-enter relationship with my faith and prayer with kin, that like with queer kin, and it's like a redefining of what that looks like has been so joyful for me. And kind of I think sometimes when there has been a history of faith, sometimes being a place of real constriction or rigidity, to find joy and lightness in conversation with God. And to kind of when there are those moments where you're just like, ah, just lightness, like the sun is shining and everything's okay. And to remember God in those moments, it has been really kind of heart opening for me, because I think sometimes in the past it's in the darkness, it's in the thickness that I'm like, please make it go away, come listen to me, you know, rather than in those joyful moments. I think presence is joyful for me. When I notice I'm awake to this moment, feels really joyful. But I was just thinking about what you were saying about kind of the hollowed nature of the way that the language of community is used. And it really stayed with me, because I think we throw it around a lot, right? And I think we do it because there's a deep, deep longing for something in it. We deeply want to belong. And we really want community to mean something. Yet I think we're so often met with the disappointments of relationship and the kind of gulfs when we're reaching for this sense of togetherness. And I guess I wanted to just ask, like, how do you navigate, both of you, this space, and you as well, just that space between kind of your imaginings or your longings and your desire for community, and then the kind of imperfect reality of it?
That's such a good question.
I've got something I could contribute to it, because it's something that I think about a lot. Like, there's a poem that I heard, and it's a Christian poem, but it was like, it says, to be above with the saints. It's talking about going to heaven, right? And going to heaven, but your relationship with being on earth. It was like, to be above with the saints we love, that's our hope and glory. But to be below with the saints we know, that's a different story. Which basically means it's like, oh, it's so great to go to heaven where everyone's going to be. But it's like, all your brethren, they're the ones that's going to heaven with you, isn't it? So it's like, there's people that we, there's always better people outside of your like immediate circle. And I think it's funny, because the closer you get to people, the closer you see their humanity. And I think the key for a beautiful community isn't necessarily that anyone's particularly good or does the right thing all the time. It's more about like it's more to do with each other's response to the offense. I'm going to offend you. But like the knowingly or unknowingly, but like the question is like, how do we respond to each other? And it's that creates the quality of the relationship. I think sometimes, especially when, like, I've come from a culture that, like, they have built community very strong from, like, Windrush era, and there was no books on community, there's no workshops on how to have a community. Like, it wasn't a thing, you just do it, right? We have to learn that, because, like, we've been so separated from just knowing how to be near people, but because we're so far away from, we start to, like, mythologize what this community is supposed to do and what it's supposed to achieve, not realizing that like the community is going to be as imperfect, if not more imperfect than you. Mm-hmm. So make yourself the measurement, right? Like, and I've realized that once there's like a level of acceptance that like, we're good, you're going to flop me, but that's cool. I'm going to flop you, I hope that's cool as well. Then like, then you can actually have a real life community. You have people that you can grow with alongside each other. I think sometimes I would say Londoners, like, But I feel like the scene that we're in, sometimes we could be in danger of mythologizing what it means to be in communion with people. Because we long for it so much, we make it bigger than what it actually is. And actually, there's quite a lot of like humbling and serious conversations and forgiveness and, okay, I have to allow it this time. There's a lot of that in order for the true beauty to come through. So I've been dealing with that, like just having to like take away this ideal set of people that are there somewhere. It's like this is us, and everything that you want to see about the future is going to grow from your neighborhood. It's growing from the people that you know around you. Like anything you imagine from the future is happen. It's going to happen within your brethren or happen within yourself. Like it's not external.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was going to echo a similar thing as well. I feel like sometimes we think of like communities, like there's no ideal group or like ideal community. Like community is messy and there's tension, mm-hmm. and it involves like difficult, sometimes years long conversations with your auntie or your dad or whoever it is. But that's part of like not treating one another as disposable as well, right? I am conscious of time because we really wanted to make time for audience questions. So do we have any questions from the audience? We've got one here.
I think we're going to go online first because we've got some... There's no questions online? Okay. We'll go to the
Just
audience.
Space for them.
Was it...
Case.
Did you... Okay.
Thanks for the presentations. It was really inspiring. It's inspiring to see things I've seen before in other places and things that I've never seen, both of which being reimagined and having such impact, so thank you. It got me thinking, in the capitalist culture that we live in, where we value newness, we value scale, we've got a societal amnesia of the past, sometimes our community work sort of mirrors that too and mirrors that expectation. So I have kind of two questions. The first one, how far is reimagining our futures actually reinvestigating our pasts, our ancestors, what we've done before, even our fairly recent history of colonialism, like that goes way back. And then the second one is how far can we think big about reimagining and be satisfied with it being at a micro scale as well? Sorry, they're two big questions.
They're great questions.
Do you want to say anything?
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I struggle with this. This is my whole plight, in a sense where there are times when I'm in a room and there's three people in the room. I'm like, this is enough. And I'm satisfied, right? But then you have a culture surround you, and the culture could just be other friends who may not be involved in what you're doing. They're like, oh, but you know, like, you need to scale it, it needs to be bigger, it needs to... And then you have that internal pressure of like, oh, maybe what I'm doing isn't enough. Like, it isn't... I think that is... Anyone who's having a community, founding a community, keeping a community going, is something that they need to be aware of. Sometimes actually you don't need that much in order to get to the place that you're looking for. Sometimes we actually don't think small enough. Sometimes you don't think detailed enough. Sometimes we make it our aspirations to think very, very big, but I don't know a lot of people who are really good at thinking in small, it's small in a good way, do you know what I mean? Not small in terms of like you're trying to get into the weeds and you're not solving anything. I have no answers for that. But like, I just want to say I acknowledge that as a thing. Because, yeah, you're always... And I think that's something that I probably will always have to deal with, whereby I can look at something and say, like, this is great. Two people came and I actually wanted two people to come. And then the external thing of people, like, oh, but it's not 5,000, though. And that's a real thing, something I deal with all the time. It really... There's a level of commitment. It takes a level of commitment to be big, but it also takes the same level of commitment to be small as well, and to make sure that like everything that is tended to is tended to, and it doesn't need the bells and whistles.
Yeah. I think just similarly, just speaking to, you know, it's a question that, you know, I love questions that we can sit in and that we can't necessarily have answers for, but there is an invitation, I think, to think about how we embody, you know, we're an embodiment of our practices. And so I think sometimes when we move to scale, and that's not to devalue, you know, scale is really important. It's incredibly important work that happens. But I think something is missed because what is the work that we are also doing on ourselves and in our interpersonal relationships that are so significant? Because, you know, I was speaking to you earlier, these systems make their way into our bodies. You know, we uphold them over ourselves. We uphold kind of, you know, you're speaking to the system of capitalism. How do I uphold, you know, the ideas of perfection or comparison or competition over myself and in my relationships, right? Even that is a lifetime's work. And so that's not to say that it has more or less important. It's all in relationship to each other. That work feeds the big scale work because we can do it with more authenticity. And I do think there's something about this constant conversation between how am I embodying in my practices the imaginings that I long for in the world, because we often think the work happens out there, and that work is incredibly important, but what are we also doing right here in our day-to-day praxis to kind of look at ourselves, and even when it's unsightly and even when it's difficult, and invite each other in relationship. You know, you were just kind of speaking to so beautifully, like, it's messy when people hold the mirror up to our shit. It's really hard when someone's like, you're moving mad, you know, or you're upholding all these systems over me or in this relationship. And so it's, how can we actually stay in the discomfort? Because a lot of this is about an embodied discomfort as well. And tolerate that to do the work required to move into a different kind of way of being in relationship. You know, to recognize conflict as a generative, really fruitful space that we might learn from. And then move into, you know, well, we're practicing new worlds when we do that. Right, we're practicing a fuller humanity and way of being in relationship. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to respond. I think it was the second question about.
Sorry, I shouldn't have given
it to you. It's okay. It's okay. The second question was about. So the first was about reimagination, and then.
The first one was about, like, going into the past. Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, so the first one, I want to quote two very special people. I think it was Akhil, who's just come in, who once said, there are no new ideas, there are just the context is new. It's just, yeah, very true. And then Fazana, who I hope is watching us, talked about integrity as alignment, values aligning with context. And also, yeah, I'm a father, so I've seen, like, a life grow. It's, like, changed my whole perception of everything. And I think it's really humbled me in that we all start off, like, and grow in the same way. We all start, there's these milestones, our brains go through these moments. And all of us, it's an amazing thing to see, but it's, like, we're not as individual and as special as we think. We react and respond to most things in the same way. And so in that way, we're not new, but the context is. And I think it's at that meeting point that a reimagination can happen. And as I said in my talk, I think I'm very, very aware. I like move with my ancestors when I do this work. Because they survived, do you know what I mean? And I'm here with what I've grown up with the cultural understanding I have of the world because of generations of that work happening, but it's not happening in the context that I'm in. Yeah. And that's where the creativity is, so, yeah.
Less questions, more of attention that we have to create.
I think we have time for one more audience question. Does anyone, this person in the yellow at the back.
Thank you so much for a beautiful conversation and discussion. So the question I have is related to showing up with wholeness, right? So in the communities and in the collectives I'm involved in, I noticed the facilitators and community organizers are deeply exhausted in holding space. And how do you hold space for others when your well is depleted? So my question is, how do you create frameworks or practices of rest for community organizers, facilitators to hold space? Yeah, that's my question.
This question is coming up a lot.
Yeah. Can I say? I think there's so much to this question. I think, first of all, it requires an attunement to ourselves to even know when we're entering into depletion. And that I think so many of us are constantly in this move to kind of doing and caught up in these cogs of capitalism, right? That we're already burnt out by the time we clock that we're burnt out. And so this is, you know, I think why I speak to this is because I think our practices are often very reactive and they happen in sites of kind of where we're in acute despair and distress rather than kind of an ongoing practice of holding where we are regularly tuning into what's here. Right? And so this is a work of presence. How can we regularly carve out spaces where we can drop into not just our emotional worlds, but be attuned to our capacity? And I think this is a thing about we need to have our own practices, our own embodied practices, and we need to have regular somatic embodied practices where we are also touching into the way emotions are showing up in our bodies and where we are regularly and transparently communicating with each other and building the muscle of being able to be vulnerable with each other and being able to hold that in community space, right? But I think, you know, we can speak to this. But this is really the work of rehearsal we're talking about, because what we're rehearsed at in society is actually, if I'm in despair or if I really express, you know, a real burnout or however that shows up, it's like, take that away, go and take medication and go and see your GP, and that belongs kind of in the hidden, closed away doors. And so it requires a lot of us. It requires us to kind of deepen our capacity to stay. And, you know, we're talking about that in relationship when there's a disappointment, but also when people are really tired or really burnt out, and we are also really tired, how can we stay with that complexity and also then name what we need and also kind of communicate in a way that's like, well, I need to tag out here. I need some time. I love you. Like, this doesn't mean that I don't love you. I can love you from over here right now. And how can I communicate that maybe someone else could step in? Or what other resources do we have around us that we really recognize that this is kind of a constellation of movement where we are moving in and out? And that's part of this work, you know? Yeah. I don't know if anyone else wants to say anything.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that I think is interesting about people who are in love work, I'm going to call it love work in terms of just community, taking care of people, they're not particularly good with boundaries. So what that then means is that, like, there's no pacing, and there's no units, there's no, like, it needs to be broken up a little bit. And actually, that's why in my work, I broke everything down into seasons. And what's actually been very interesting about it is that, like, my goal was to be creative for my whole life, all the time. I realized you can't do that. It's life energy, right? So you can't do that consistently. So what I then done is like, cool, I'm gonna be creative once a week for 6 weeks at a time and call it a season. And what's interesting is that, like, people then say, oh, is the season, our season about to finish, isn't it? So, like, I've now signaled that I'm active for a period of time and I'm gonna be inactive for a period of time. But also, so outside of my work, I take a sabbatical once a week. So on Sundays, don't call me. Or you could call me, but like, don't talk about work, don't talk about anything to do with imagination, like, leave it. Like, wait till Monday, Saturday or Monday. But like, on Sundays, I'm not involved. And actually, I love those conversations more than anybody, but on Sundays, I'm not having a conversation. But then also as well, what I started to do earlier this year is that I took that a step further. So this is a privileged thing, because I'm freelance, I'm in charge of my own time. I said that I'm going to work for 6 weeks at a time, and then on the seventh week I'm not going to do anything. So literally, tomorrow, the link up, if you come to the link up, the link up's going to be the last thing that I do, and then actually next week I'm resting the whole week. And what I found is that, and actually on top of that as well, there's a time in my day every day that's sacred to me. No one knows about it, but that's my time. So I still am tired, but I know that I've got slots in my week, slots in my day, slots in my month where I can recharge. And the thing that's actually been interesting is that when I come back from the seventh week, my whole approach to everything's different. Things that I thought was deeply important is not that important. Entire projects get deleted. Like, I have a level of clarity that allows me to actually be creative rather than just producing loads of things all the time. So that is not necessarily just about recovery. It's about, like, there needs to be a slot in your life where you can evolve. Yeah. It's not just like I need to get back to ground. It's like there's a place where I'm actually growing, yeah. But it's not in the public. There's a time in a day, there's a time in a week, there's a time in a month. Mm-hmm. So making those spaces sacred is as important as making spaces for everybody else. Because yeah. I only know my level of leadership because of how I lead myself first. Mm-hmm. And then I'm able to be like, all right, cool. Like, I can like share some stuff, but it's definitely a self-leadership thing before it is a communal leadership thing.
Can I just add one thing, though, about boundaries, about the language of boundaries? Because I think it's incredibly important, and these practices of replenishment and growth, and where we kind of know our edges, and for that to also be porous, I think feels really important. But I think sometimes the language of boundaries is co-opted to kind of perpetuate a disposability culture and to kind of feed into an avoidance of what's difficult. And I think it's important that we can kind of monitor, like, and be aware when that's happening. Because I think we are, like, as a culture, getting more and more practiced at using sort of therapy words, like boundaries, as a way to be like, I don't want to deal with you. I don't want to have to be with what's difficult right now. And so, yes, we need to know our edges and to really take care of what's here. But we need to recognize that our edges are porous and that we're still interconnected. We're still in relationship, even when we're kind of stepping away. That I'm still connected to you, right? We can't kind of sever, right? And I think sometimes that's where it goes into. It's like the edges become sharp. They become like big walled castles and locked up gates. And it's like, you ain't coming in here ever again, you know? And so I think there's, yeah. I just wanted to add that, sorry. Yeah.
André, I just love the idea that you have secret time carved out in the day that no one knows about. I think we're almost at time, but Kwame, did you have anything even short that you wanted to add on that?
Yeah, I can make it short. I was basically going to say what André said at the end, and to speak to the question of scale, I read this, I don't know if it's a cliche book, it's a really good book, All About Love by Bell Hooks, and the idea of self-love and practice of love starting with yourself. And it's not something that I've always done, but something that I've been forced to learn, is like, how can you grow a community if you can't practice it with your most intimate people? And I actually think this idea of scale, personally, I'm not that interested in it anymore. I think as human beings, again, like, we weren't thinking of like every other person on the planet before when we moved or when we interacted with people that we could see. And I think it can be like a little bit like misleading and like confusing and distracting. That's what I'm looking for, distracting when you're thinking about scale, when you haven't, you're not being in community of people around you. So I think starting with yourself, like self-love, replenishment, which is something a lot of us have to learn, I think is really important. And then the practice of community with people that you feel like you can practice it with, and then growing it outwards, I think is the way to go. I was also gonna say, me and Aman have been speaking a lot about us really enjoying the work, actually, and not just doing things because we think this person wants this and this person wants that. And I think, for me, at least on my journey, I'm the kind of person before that would have always been thinking about everyone else. And where we're at with Stone Center, in a way, is like, what things really excite us to then make exciting for other people. And I think you've got to like light the fire inside yourself before you can light in other people. So yeah.
That's a beautiful note to end on. It feels sad cutting the conversation. Oh. I I was going to say, it feels sad to be the one who has to like cut the conversation, but we have part two of this series of events next week, which is going to be on experiments in imagination, where we're going to continue conversations about art and community practice and its role in kind of imagining new futures and actually putting those futures into practice. I want to say a huge thank you to our speakers. You've been so good. To the audience as well, and the energy you've brought to the room. To the Healing Justice London team, who have been quietly working so hard to put this event together. To our interpreters, Sophie and Julie, who have done an amazing job. Thank you. Thank you all so much. And if you want to find out more information or about how to attend the event next week, I think there should be flyers on your chairs. So have a look. Thank you again, and have a good evening.